Oh, there we go. Okay, so everybody had lunch, you had a chance to rest a little bit, and now you're all energized and wanting to know about learner-centered design, right? Am I right? Okay, all right. How many people have been to any of the other curriculum ideology presentations that we had? So who went to Tom's presentation yesterday about academic scholar? Yeah? And Brent Parkin, my colleague, did some presentations just before this. Anybody go to those? Yeah? Yeah. So this is the fourth of the curriculum ideologies that we want to talk about. And the purpose of this is not to tell you here is a right way or a wrong way. It's a way to be mindful of your own practice. So it's a way to be mindful of what your institution is doing, what your goals are, so that you can focus your practice on your goals. So we talk about these four curriculum ideologies, and the book that we're referencing here is by Michael Shiro from Boston College, and it's just called Curriculum Theory. And what he has done is a really great overview, a sort of a history of education and how there are these competing at times and complementary at times different strands or threads or focuses or philosophies of what we think we're doing when we're doing education. If I were to ask all of you, write down three words that mean education to you, probably we'd see a lot of diversity because people focus on different things, and that is okay. Your institution has purposes. There are different things that you're trying to do. And the different ideologies can be, this is what I call my big egg diagram, because I had to make a diagram for my dissertation, so forgive me here. I nested the different ideologies in terms of the scope of community that they attempt to address. So in the center, we have the learner-centered ideology, and that's about just the needs and goals of the individual learner. Moving out to the scholar academic, about finding and encouraging the best of the best into careers as scholars. The social efficiency ideology, which is about helping everyone get to a certain point of mastery with some critical skills and abilities. And then the social justice or social reconstruction ideology, which is about trying to prepare students to change the world in the future, to take on active participant and leadership roles in the world. And that's, in a way, kind of an opposite of the learner-centered because it's about the needs of the many, and the learner-centered is really focused on the needs of the one. Now, you could be doing both of these. You could be doing all four of these at once. You could be doing different ones on different days. But if what you want to do is something focusing on the individual needs of the learner, that's what we're going to talk about in this session. So the learner-centered ideology, as a metaphor, you know, we think about different ways we could think of learning. It could be, you know, the tabula rasa, fill my empty head with knowledge. It could be, you know, kind of a revolutionary or an apprenticeship model. The learner-centered model is about growth. It's about helping each individual grow to their greatest potential in the way that works best for them. It's about the self. It's not about preparing for a role anywhere else. It's about self-actualization. It's not looking at the past or the present or the future. Time is not the point of this ideology. It is developmental and constructivist. It is about developing the greatest capabilities of the individual, but it's measured by how the learner feels about what they're learning and where their interests and focuses at any given time. If you are doing this, you cannot give a multiple choice quiz and say, you know, list the five essential elements of the learner-centered ideology or something. I mean, what kind of sense would that make? You could give a survey and ask learners, how satisfied are you with this program? Or you could just watch their happy faces, hopefully. Somebody I know recommends the best way to know if you're doing it right is if the learners won't leave the room at the end of the class. If they're still talking to each other and to you and engaging, they're not done yet, then that's a good job. If we were trying to do learning analytics about this ideology, almost the only thing I could say is they vote with their feet. If they're logging into your system, they're getting some use out of the system. And there's not a lot else you can do. This isn't about learning analytics. It's about encouraging learners to be self-motivated, self-regulated, and to be able to work on their own individual goals. Nonetheless, there are some activities in Moodle that will particularly encourage that. I'll get to in just a moment. If you wanted to have a survey, these are some sample questions that you might ask your learners. To what extent do you agree with these statements? So this is your typical post-course evaluation, right? But it's very focused on the learner's individual experience. I was able to articulate my personal learning goals in this module, and the environment helped me to meet my learning goals. So we don't see this a lot in higher ed. Most of the time, if you sign up for a course at a college or a university, there's some list of stuff that they say they're going to teach you. In this case, we're asking our students to tell us, what do you want to learn today? Why are you here? What is your goal? What is your motivation? What's important to you? Now, if you want to combine this, you could do something like what I did in my statistics classes that I used to take, where I'd say, we're going to cover this statistical method this week. What would you like to analyze? Here's a tool. I want to help you use this tool on something you care about. Here's an example, a couple of examples of how you might use the t-test to compare means in two different piles of data. Here are a couple of other examples, and I try to make them more about words than numbers and say, do you have a problem like this? Do you have something that you're interested in solving that this tool could be used for? I want to help you do that. That's partly learner-centered and partly social efficiency because I have an obligation to try to get them all past the finish line with a certain set of skills. But I want to do it in a way that helps the learner identify with the material and say, ah, yes, I didn't just take a statistics course. I took a course that helped me use statistics for stuff I care about. So my students would come up with things like, I live in maple sugar country, so they'd say, well, I want to compare the maple yield, the maple syrup yield from my trees this year to the last 3 years. Awesome project. I had somebody who was interested in the Boston Marathon. I want to look at which countries or which parts of the world the winners of the marathons tend to come from. Great project. Had somebody, remember when Barry Bonds and Sammy Sosa were duking it out for number of home runs? Had a student say, I want to know if the number of home runs they hit was actually statistically significantly different. Way to go. I have trouble remembering those guys' names. I really am not into baseball. It doesn't have a point. My student was into it. And I bet he still remembers that project, too. So that's how we can bring that into whatever we're doing, if it's appropriate for you to do that. So there's a set of tools, and you'll recognize these. Database activity gets pulled into everything because you can use it for so many different things. But these are some of the tools that you can use in Moodle to encourage your students in this learner-centered kind of methodology. So with the wiki, for example, you can set up an individual wiki. This isn't so much about group work. This is about writing and reflection and revision and asking somebody early on, what are your current thoughts about some topic? And then asking them later, reflect back on your previous thoughts. Has this changed? What do you think about it now? Do you feel like your understanding of this has grown? Do you feel like your enthusiasm for it is different than it was at the beginning? Choice activity, we can gather multiple learner input on single topics like, what shall we use for an example next week in class that you would all be kind of interested in? So again, with my statistics example, if I do a sports thing, is everybody going to be good with that? Should I pick something else? How about if I do M&Ms? That's always a popular one, the color of M&Ms. So I'll bring in little packages of things and we'll do that. So you can ask people what they want to do. One of the most important tools that we have in the learner-centered methodology is integrations with various portfolio systems or ways that you can set up portfolios within Moodle, even using something like the database activity. And the point of a portfolio in this model is that you're helping a learner collect and curate their work for their reasons. So let's say that we're talking about a drawing class, and at the beginning, or a photography class, even easier. At the beginning, you have the learners go out and shoot some pictures. You have them post them with their comments. Later on in the course, as they, you know, look at more different techniques and take more pictures, they start to curate. They start to say, I really like this picture because I felt like I got the lighting just right. Or a learner might want to say, here are two pictures, one that I did early in the term, one that I did late in the term, and they're very similar, except that I got the framing just right on this one. So I'm really pleased with how I've become more aware of framing. That's the evaluation. The learner is pleased with how much they've grown. They're pleased with how much they can do now, more than they could do before. So here's the question. Does your Moodle course, if you have one, reflect your institution's learning ideology? And some of you have been to some of the other sections. Maybe you've had a chance to think about this. How many people here feel like the learner-centered ideology is at least somewhat relevant to the teaching that happens at your institution? Wow. Okay. People are a little slow. Could we try that again and this time keep them up so I can get a sense of... Okay. All right. So a little bit. So how many people work at an institution that says they are learner-centered? A few more hands this time. And I used to work at one, too, and they didn't necessarily mean this philosophy of learning. Maybe they meant customer-oriented or something like that. That's not necessarily the same thing, so I want us to be aware of the difference between this philosophy and other things that might also be called learner-centered, because we use words in different ways, and that's okay, too. To give you a kind of ideal, how many people here have heard of or are involved with the maker movement? Makers? Okay, we've got a couple. How many people have a hobby that they spend a lot of time getting good at? Ah, there we go. How many people, in the process of pursuing their hobby, ended up learning something that they didn't know they were going to be learning, but it worked out because, yeah, pretty much everybody who has a hobby. The learner-centered model, when applied in schools, and this is used in K-12 kind of environments, assumes that if you let the learners pick something they are passionate about and you encourage that, they will learn the other stuff along the way. And it actually works out that way more often than not. It's not always what the rest of the community is comfortable doing, but it actually does work pretty well. So the benefits of this kind of philosophy, if it can be a part of your model, are that the learner learns to set their own goals. They learn to look for environments and resources and tools and mentors and continue to teach themselves and learn all their lives. They start to value experience over products, and that makes them more resilient if a product doesn't turn out quite the way they want it. They can look at an experiment, like a loaf of bread that didn't rise, and say, wow, I learned to make flatbread. And they organize other pieces of their life. They start to notice everything that could touch their subject, and you help them and encourage them to open up their world, to see how the thing that they care about connects to many other things. So that's, if you choose to bring this kind of learning into your classroom, or if you choose to pursue this as a learner, these are the kinds of things that you can do. that's it for prepared slides. Do I have a little time for questions? Okay, questions? Yeah.
So how do you, have a strategy for identifying what type of learning you see or what type of learning or what different, what combination of four different elements go into how you would approach something like this?
Okay, so the question is, if I understand you correctly, how do you know which of these you're doing or which ones you're trying to do? Or what combination you're trying to do. And that's something that I don't have a checklist for it, but we do have some examples, and we're producing more examples. We're actually going to have some training modules that we're creating for each of these ideologies, and then I'm hoping that we'll also have some sample courses in a couple of different topics taught in these modes. And these will help give you a better idea of what it looks like in practice so that you can look at your own situation and say, okay, I see elements of this, I see elements of that. It's not important to pick one. It's not important to know which one is your favorite or to studiously avoid one. The idea here is just to be more aware so that you can align what you're doing with what you're trying to do. Other questions? Thank you so much for your time.
All right, thank you, Elizabeth. Next, we have Paul Tannehill with Can Education Technologists Really Drive Change?